Welcome to the podcast today. So maybe would you like to suggest what topic we can discuss and then we can take it forward today?
Okay. So we all know a rainbow with its seven distinct bright colors. How about a ugly rainbow? Let me explain. In this ugly rainbow, there are different shades, but each of them is a witness to the misery and the stressful life that people are experiencing in the current age. So although it's a rainbow, and although there are seven distinct colors, they're all connected. And they simply, looking at them without being armed with the wisdom of Bhagavad Gita or Srimad Bhagavatam, we simply could be like a mere cog in the wheel and lead a very, very miserable existence. So,
yeah. I'll just so you're referring to materialism, sensuality, or capitalism, or what is the rainbow referring to basically?
Well, I say it begins with the way in which meritocracy tells you how to work, your work defines you, and then the kind of love which you see as a reward of the hard work you have done is mainly very external. As a result, you are constantly anxious. You are left with no alternative but to simply keep on consuming, and you are kind of crowned as the king. Everything is done for you. You, the consumer, you are the real king. And the media around you, the news, entertainment, everything is simply so terrifying, sometimes pessimistic. And as a result, even like having no spare time for festivals, for friends, for leisure is seen as a very successful person. So this is a very sweeping way of looking at the current way in which people live and work.
Okay, that's quite comprehensive. I think it will have to go into each of those points specifically. So one thought I had when you mentioned rainbow, the rainbow looks very attractive. So similarly, none of these might really say, for example, I guess consumer is the king. This itself doesn't look like an alarming idea. It looks like a wonderful idea. But when you go into it, then you realize that there are problems with it. So in that sense, it's a rainbow which is deceptive. It has its appeal, but it turns into a trap. So this could relate with the Bhagavad Gita, which says that yattad agre amrutopamam pariname vishamiva. So that which is like nectar in the beginning turns out to be like poison in the end. So probably we could start with meritocracy then, because yes, it does seem very attractive. So meritocracy, from what I have read, is the idea that merit determines people's social trajectory, their success in life, their position, or that's how it should be. And this was a relatively recent idea. Napoleon Bonaparte is attributed to have, at least in the Western thought, propagated it. Before him, it was one's birth, one's lineage that determined one's trajectory. So where you came from would determine to a large extent where you would go. So basically, if we consider our life, there is the past, there is the present, and there is the future. So prior to meritocracy, there was aristocracy. Of course, only some people were aristocrats, but there was a hierarchy accordingly. So it could be like from where you have come, your past is the primary determiner of your present and your future. Whereas meritocracy holds that your past doesn't matter at all. How you work, how you are dedicated, creative, resourceful, that will determine your future. So in a sense, either we attribute everything to the past, to factors beyond our control, or we attribute everything to factors within our control. So meritocracy is the idea that we determine whatever we want to achieve. So there are quotes like, whatever the human mind can conceive, it can achieve. Or, you know, whatever we think, we do. There are the idea that thoughts and intentions will lead to the actualized reality based on individual merit. So if something goes wrong in your life, if you're not able to fulfill your dreams, if you're not able to achieve something worthwhile, that's because there's something wrong with you presently. It doesn't acknowledge that there is a role played by things beyond us. So how do you think meritocracy is a problem in terms of today's, say, mental health crisis or the distress that people are experiencing?
I have some thoughts and just observations. I don't claim to have made some empirical research on that. But if you see, especially in the Western fairy tales, it is always, there are so many stories of the son of a farmer becoming a king, the peasant boy who does something meritorious and gets the hand of the princess.
Or we have the other way also, Cinderella's kind of stories, where a girl who is perceived, yeah, he also rises above her situations. Now, one reason why these stories are so popular is because they are so exceptional.
That is one thing. And also they continue giving hope to someone that work hard. And maybe if you're lucky, you might get your lucky break. So the word break is a break away from your past life. And then you begin a new chapter. Hmm. But for the most part, like even from the Dark Ages, the Crusades, the Renaissance, Industrial Revolution, mostly the lot of the common masses was always miserable. So for a few stories here and there of somebody becoming a inventor and then becoming fabulously rich, there are very few. Hmm. In fact, many would discover something and then they would die poor. Just a small example, Charles Goodyear. There is a Goodyear tire company, which is a $1 billion corporation. It has nothing to do with Charles Goodyear, who discovered the process of vulcanizing rubber, but died penniless. Just taking pity on him, the merchant who purchased his patent, or a group of them, in order to honor his memory, they named it the Goodyear Tire Company.
Oh, but he didn't get any remuneration.
He didn't get anything.
Yeah. I think there's also a famous science war between Nikola Tesla and someone where one of them took the credit where the other did the actual inventions.
So, anyway. So it is always like that. And but there is always this lure, the attraction that yes. And as you rightly pointed out, if you like this quotation that somebody asked a rich businessman that, sir, are you lucky? He said, yes. And the harder I work, the luckier I get. Now, before somebody could feel that we are against hard work, I would like to clearly say this, that is not the case. We are not advocating laziness or kind of inactivity as an antidote to this, but the mere fact that you alone are responsible for your success or failure kind of makes a person stunted in his internal growth. You have any other like a sweeping accusation against meritocracy?
No, this is an important point, what you said. Among the contemporary authors, for well-known authors, I found some who have almost a spiritual understanding of reality. So there is this Elizabeth Gilbert, who's famous for Eat, Pray, Love.
Yeah.
She writes how most of the top authors of the last century had severe mental health issues, and some of them even committed suicide. And he gives a quite a significant list of those. So one reason is that at one level, creativity is something which is just channeled through us. So somebody might write a novel that is received rave reviews and becomes celebrated. And then after that, when they sit down to write the next thing, just nothing comes to them. And then if you come to the realization, or you start feeling that, you know, my best lies behind me, and I can never replicate that best, then that can cripple a person completely, and that can even lead to suicidal thoughts. So I was that good, but now I'm over here. How can I accept this? So even if one doesn't accept that there is anything higher, but as a psychological model, if we understand that if we accept or propose that there are higher creative energies within the existence, and those creative energies act through us when they want. So then it's like our writing efforts, our creative efforts are like placing ourselves in the river of creative flow. And sometimes the water flows and then we get a lot. Sometimes we get little, sometimes we get nothing. So the idea that even especially in creativity, it's not just our endeavor. Our endeavor is definitely important. But recognizing that there is something beyond us. Now here we are talking about something different in a sense that it is our own talents are not entirely our own. Just like in cricket, sometimes a player might be a very good player, but they just seem to be out of form. Nobody wants to be out of form, but they just go out of form. So sometimes they just have to wait till they get to a stage where their form comes back. Or sometimes they're in a purple patch where they're performing superlatively. But for how long? So this, that there is definitely the role, merit matters, no doubt. And some people are more meritorious than others. But does merit alone matter? That is the question. So by taking sole credit for our abilities and our achievements, we might be placing too much of a burden on ourselves. So yeah. When those achievements don't come, so this is two different things. One is the achievements don't come because the circumstances are no longer favorable. Say the world economy changes and say a particular genre of movies or books or artwork just goes out of fashion. So the achievement doesn't come. But worse is, abilities itself don't seem to be manifesting through us. Then merit matters, but merit alone doesn't matter. And working hard to develop our meritism, to earn merit or to develop our talents is important, but that is not all important. And this belief that our merit alone determines our results can cripple us when either the ability stops manifesting or the achievements stop coming. What are your thoughts about this?
Yeah, so should we take these points, discuss them as much as possible, and then give a spiritual response as to how that particular point? So two points here. I feel particularly optimistic when I hear Krishna speaking very categorically that buddhir buddhimatam asmi tejas tejas vinamaham balam balavatam chaham and paurusham nrishu. So
yes.
I am the intelligence of the intelligent. I am the strength of the strong. I am the ability in a person, and specifically I am the cutting edge, that particular merit which makes you shine forth among fellow humans. So that is the first point. And then I see a dazzling example in the life of Arjun when he is on an errand. He has to transport the queens of Dwarka and some primitive cowherds with primitive weapons, sticks and stones, they defeat him. So that was a time, just a few months ago, here is the hero of one of the biggest conflicts the world has ever seen, and personally guided by Krishna, is now saying that it's the same Arjuna with the same bow and the same arrow and the same chariot. How come I am defeated by people who are not even in my class? So he says, there is a deeper meaning behind this. So rather than trying to enhance his archery skills, he goes inward and comes to a much better conclusion that there is a deeper meaning behind this. This has all been orchestrated by the will of Krishna, the Supreme Lord himself. And just as I was not very elated when the battle was won, I should not be getting depressed now, seeing, as you said, sometimes there is no water, there is no flow. So I am detached from the achievements or defeats in my daily life here.
Yeah, beautiful example. So in some ways, we could say that the broad Vedic culture was hierarchical. There were varanas, and people's life trajectory was to some extent determined by their birth. But even within that, it was not merit alone.
Yes.
It is, there are factors beyond merit also which shape results. And so you said 2 points. One was that it is so when we say that Krishna says, I am the ability in human beings, what it essentially means is that he may choose to manifest as the ability, and sometimes he may not manifest the ability. So in one of my Gita Daily articles, I wrote a quote that our abilities are gifts. To know that our abilities are gifts is a greater gift. And to know the source of our abilities is the greatest gift. So if we can use our abilities to know their source, to know God, who is all attractive. The Bhagavad Gita also says, yad yad vibhuti mat sattvam. Whatever is attractive is a spark of Krishna's splendor. So merit, rather than taking credit for what I am doing, I see that, okay, there is something higher acting through me. I think it is Srila Prabhupada, when he was very successful in doing bhakti outreach, and some of his other god brothers spoke something negative about him. So he said that, this is also their mission. If our guru, if Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur is choosing to act through me, then it is not that I am doing something separate. It is the same channel of spirituality that is running through them and through me. So at one sense a spiritual vision can have, let God work through others the way he wishes, and let God work through me as he wishes. So if we know that source, if we know our abilities come from our Lord, from Krishna, then we use the abilities to stay connected with him. And whether they lead to an impact in the world, whether they lead to recognition in the world, that doesn't matter so much to us. The spiritual worldview can help us use our abilities and get intrinsic satisfaction to some extent, which may not come if we consider that the abilities are our own, and these abilities will determine our achievements.
Okay, I have this famous example used by many of our, at least my senior colleagues here. I'm just comparing abilities with a wallet.
Okay.
So picking somebody's wallet in a metro train or a bus or on the street is hijacking somebody's abilities, or that's outright criminal. You have picked somebody's pocket.
Okay.
Utilizing something which is in your own wallet, at least you're not a criminal, but you're not exactly understanding that this is a gift, as you rightly said. But seeing a wallet on the street, picking it up, finding the name on it, and returning it to the owner is a sign of culture.
Okay.
So somebody may utilize somebody else's abilities and claim on their own, like people write, somebody writes a poem, somebody writes a book, and somebody says, this is mine, they claim plagiarism, whatever. That's criminal. Civil behavior is just utilizing what you have. But highly developed spiritual cultures, they have people who show extraordinary merit, but they always give due credit to the source, that I am just a conduit, I am just a conveyor belt of, as you said, sometimes people write poems and which are fantastic poems, or they write novels or whatever, and they don't know how the inspiration came and they can't duplicate it. So at least in their honest moments, they know they are not the source of their merit. But in the absence of training and culture, they don't know to whom should I give the credit. So this point of Bhagavad Gita, that I am the ability, I am the cutting edge, I am the giver of intelligence to the intelligent, that helps society in what, according to you, is the highest gift.
Yes. So we don't minimize meritocracy, but we don't absolutize it. We don't minimize merit. Meritocracy means merit is absolutized, but we contextualize merit in terms of where it is coming from, and that there are higher factors which will determine where it will take us or where it may not take us. And this leads us to, maybe we should move to the next point.
We can segue into the connecting point about what defines you.
Okay.
So in our ugly rainbow shade, my work defines me. If I am working at a particular industry, at a particular level, if I'm earning something, or I'm so busy, then that means I'm successful, I'm productive, so on and so forth.
Yeah. We could say that there are, at one level, people will be defined by their work. That's just natural. Because if you meet someone, you want to know, okay, what do you do? The person has to put a nameplate, they're going to put something like their profession or something. But there, so there is a functional identification and there's a fundamental identification. At a functional level, it's required that we are defined by our work, our social roles and responsibilities. But at a fundamental level, if I define myself by my work alone, then it can lead to problems. Because after all, work is to some extent extrinsic to us. If I define myself as a software engineer, and then tomorrow, maybe for whatever reason, I can't work as a software engineer. Maybe I lose that job and don't get a job anywhere else. Some people we may have to reinvent ourselves. So if our work defines us, then it just doesn't refer only to how I see myself, but also forms like a bracket in which the world sees us. So maybe within the world, certain professions are glamorized and people with those professions are looked up. Say, for example, in India, it is said that if you don't become an engineer or a doctor, then if your child doesn't become an engineer or doctor, then it's not that your child is a failure, you are a failure. So this could vary. I think in the pre-independence times, it was more of, the word was barrister. The dream of people was that you go to America and you become a barrister and then you come back. Not America.
London returned.
Yeah, sorry.
They would put that in the nameplate, London returned.
Oh, okay. So if our work defines us, then this is, we're putting the cart before the horse. It is we, based on our talents, our interests, our nature, it is we who should be defining our work. Not that we let our work define us. So sometimes if we put it that way, then we might lifelong be caught in work that is incompatible to us, and we do it just because of the extrinsic results in terms of position and fame and wealth that we get from it, but we are dissatisfied by it. Also, this is one. Any thoughts on this?
Yeah, there is a often used saying called "keeping up with the Joneses." Heard of that?
Yes, keeping up.
So, if my work defines me, then I try to mix with people whom I define, who I also feel as successful, because I try to go to that pecking order, as they say. And anytime I see someone more than me, I feel small, I feel jealous. Anytime I feel someone lesser than me, I feel proud, I feel successful. So in general, this ugly thing of your work defining you keeps you always in the competitive mode. There is always the next horizon to conquer. And actually, there is no horizon, because by the time you reach that particular point which you thought was a horizon, the horizon has just gone 20 miles behind.
Yeah. I read a book by an Ivy League professor. It is called Excellent Sheep. And okay. He had earlier used the word sheeple.
Yeah.
So he's an excellent sheep. He says that basically he quotes some survey that was done in several Ivy League universities, and the students over there have two prominent emotions. One is grandiosity and the other is insecurity. So if I see how smarter I am than others, then I feel grandiose. But as soon as I see somebody who is smarter than me, I feel insecure. So in that sense, if we let our work define us, then there is very little security or stability coming from within. And that is not a very pleasant place to be in.
You always tend to gravitate towards, as you said, you have to escape from the feeling of being inferior, that okay, this person always makes me feel how low or how less IQ I have. So I then gravitate towards those who are lesser than me, just so that they make me feel superior and comfortable. And this is the bane of so many political parties, so many scientific institutions. In fact, so many spheres of life today, we have this thing that work defines the person.
So if work defines the person, it also means that people don't have time for other aspects of their life. And
yes,
often they consider it more a matter of prestige. I have so much work to do, and I don't have time for this, I don't have time for that. So there was some study done, published in the London School of Economics, something says, when work becomes home. So people prefer to spend more time in their workplace because they feel things are organized over there. And if they go home, they have spouses whom they don't know how to relate with. They have kids whom they can't manage. So from an emotional perspective, relations become undercut. And when work defines us, generally in the workplace, we can't have that much personal relationship. Of course, we will have some relationship, but it is very competitive. I can't expose my vulnerability to anyone because they might exploit me. So then that could also be one reason why so many people are so lonely. It's that if my self-definition is in terms of my work, then that leads to I not wanting to or being willing to adjust my life so that I spend enough time for developing relationships. And then naturally I feel lonely. Now, this is, of course, a different subject. In some ways, feminism can also turn toxic, where if women start defining themselves by their work and they feel childcare or home maintenance is not a glamorous enough work, then they start neglecting that for their professions. And the result of that could be that children don't get enough attention. They themselves feel stressed by all the competition. And again, we are not necessarily restricting women to a particular gender role, a particular social role, but the idea that work defines us can have a lot of negative consequences, individually at an emotional level and at the level of a family. And family is the basic unit of society. That will also get affected.
Yeah. So remember in monasticism, we had discussion in the recent past about this subject. So there was a thing of dignity of labor. And I'm just taking one thread from that. So in the monasteries, abbeys, or spiritual ashrams, there was this thing where, and there's a story of Mahatma Gandhi, that somebody came to, some Westerner came with an appointment that, is Mahatma Gandhi available? And they said, yes, but it will be about an hour before he meets you. So he said, that's okay. And then he saw him with a broom and with those implements which are used to clean the toilets. So he said, I am surprised that you are doing this kind of thing. He said, no, I am a member of the ashram here and we take turns. So it is not like I am just a sweeper of restrooms or a cleaner of restrooms here. At the same time, I am not just the head of the thought leader of this ashram over here. I am part the leader and also I'm a part of the labor force here. So the idea that what I'm doing doesn't define me.
Oh, okay.
I do this thing because I happen to be the thought leader. I don't deny that. And at the same time, I do the menial services also, which kind of balances everything, keeps everything harmonious.
Yeah, it's a very insightful example. So there is this thought associated with the Bhagavad Gita called work is worship.
Yes.
Now, some people say that means just you do work, you don't have to do any worship at all. But a more appropriate understanding could be do your work in a mood of worship. So if we consider that way, work is worship. The Gita's specific translation is Swakarmanatam Abhyarcha. Specific, that is work as worship, work in the mood of worship. So initially I was quite critical of, I loved the idea before I was introduced to the actual study of the Gita. Work is worship sounds very good. But when I studied the Gita, I said this is an oversimplification. This is almost a distortion. But now I understand that work is worship is a valid ethical principle. It need not be a valid philosophical principle in the sense that do your work in a mood of worship, that is to infuse dignity to all labor, that is good. But if we equate work itself with to worship and then we say that there is no need to worship, then that is objectionable. But if we are to be defined by our work, then we will very meticulously want to hold on to a particular work only and refuse to do anything else, because that downgrades our conception of ourselves and that of others. So even in the Bhakti tradition, we have Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appreciating Pratap Rudra, who was the king of Orissa, for becoming a sweeper in front of the Jagannath Rath cart. And yes. So that means he was ready to go beyond his official role as the king to demonstrate his humility before God as a servant of Jagannath. And he did that in a very careful, reverential way, and that pleased the Lord. So our work doesn't define us. We define our work, and our self-worth doesn't necessarily depend on our on the prestige of the work we are doing. Our self-worth exists independent. So our self-worth is, I say in today's world often, our self-worth is determined by our net worth. But it doesn't have to be like that.
Yeah.
So that's about work. So if I believe, if we go to, should we go to the next point now or anything more?
Yeah, we just have point for one more point.
Yeah.
Time so that we can take the next four in the next session.
Okay. So first we discussed about merit, that your merit will determine your success. And therefore, then we move to that. You are defined by your work. And if I'm defined by my work, then now there are two related points. This is that it can lead me to a lot of anxiety. And then maybe we can, the law part we can take a little later. Can you talk about anxiety
now? Okay. You think that this is the natural progression into the way in which your meritocracy is defined, then how work defines me, and a very, very natural outcome of this toxic culture is I'm always anxious.
Yes.
Sada samudvigna dhyam.
Sada. Now, Krishna in the Bhagavata says that chintam aparimeyam cha pralayantam upashritaha, and the next part is kamopabhoga parama etavadi nishchitaha. So as long as we think that the worldly objects are sources of pleasure for us, we sentence ourselves to anxiety. In many ways, anxiety is the defining characteristic of modernity. At one level, we could say people have always been anxious. That is true. Everybody, material world is a place of anxiety. At the same time, the extent of anxiety is much more. And not only that, it's paradoxical because in many ways, in today's world, there is more security and certainty, especially in the developed countries, than in the underdeveloped countries. And yet those are the places where there is more anxiety. So there's not much, of course, the current pandemic is an exceptional crisis, but generally people don't have to worry about where they will get their next meal from or whether they will have power supply when they turn on their switch, or whether in the turn on the tap water will come or not. So there is increasing comfort, increasing certainty in many ways, and still there is increasing uncertainty, increasing anxiety. So that is, it is quite paradoxical, and I'll say it's revealing. So any thoughts about this point of anxiety? Researchers are talking about an anxiety epidemic also. The mental health crisis, which according to the WHO is going to be the biggest health crisis of the current century. This results from not just the fact that our economies are unstable, we might lose our jobs, but it is because I define myself so much by my job, I define myself so much by my money, the money that I have, that I can't hear it.
I find this, can I start my point here?
Yeah, please, yes.
Yeah, you talked about the anxiety epidemic. Consistently, this is by choice neglected or by ignorance neglected. Of course, if you're ignorant, you can't neglect because you don't know that it exists. That's mostly by choice that we are what we eat. Ahar shuddho, sattva shuddhi, sattva shuddhi, sadharam ranchidam, vipra moksha. So unless the food is nourishing, sattvic, promoting higher values, there is no way your mind can be sattvic. That means at peace, basically. Mm-hmm. And if anxiety is a disease of the mind, then the food has to have big, big role to play in fostering the anxiety epidemic. So now, most consumers in the developed world, they hardly see how their food is obtained. they go to a very super clean supermarket where everything is nicely labeled, packed properly, odorless, colorless, and anxiety-less. But that particular piece of meat is actually harvested from factory farms or what is called industrial meat. And they are simply, it's like a daily holocaust going there hour after hour, day after day, week after week. The people who work in these establishments, they are the ones who are susceptible to the most occupational hazards, and they also have the most anxiety. So the rest of the majority of the population, they don't know what they are eating. But when your food itself comes as a product of, as a byproduct of tremendous anxiety, stress, horror, pain, torture, it has to come some way. I'm just reading 2 days ago that in the UK, the primary cause for adults above 45 or 50 males is suicide. More people die from suicide other than any other disease. So
I knew it was high, but it is not. I didn't know it was number one. That's
yeah. So we have touched loneliness a little bit here and there. Maybe we can have a separate discussion on that. But that prompted the UK to have a minister for
loneliness. Yes.
Why? Because people are anxious, social anxiety, or just the fear that something wrong is going to happen to me. And just aside, that Stephen King, one of the most prolific horror authors today, successful as well as prolific also, one of the choice settings for his novels is small town America. Nothing much is happening there. Everything seems to every day go just like the previous one. And suddenly all hell breaks loose. So this nagging thought that something somewhere is going to harm me. I don't exactly know what's happening. And of course, now the coronavirus has kind of brazenly exposed everything. But otherwise, even during so-called peaceful times, there is always anxiety. Like I remember, after Nixon was Lyndon Johnson, and it was during the last days of the Vietnam War. Later Lyndon Johnson wrote in his memoir that those were the most anxiety-ridden days of my life. Now, of course, having such a high public office is giving anxiety, and no president is immune from that. But the fact is that right from the top person, like these things which we discussed, meritocracy, work defining you, is not just for a blue-collar worker in overhauls. It is also for the top CEO of the CEO of a corporation or the top public office holder in any country. So this is like a generic problem all over the world, that anxiety.
Yes. Yes, there's a lot of points here. Just one example which came to my mind, that say if I'm standing firmly and somebody just comes and pushes me, I'm shaken a little bit. But if I feel that the earth under me is quaking, then I'm just thrown off.
Yeah.
So if I define myself by my work and my success in my work, then failure over there is not like somebody pushing me. It is like the earth under me quaking. If I define myself as a spiritual being, as a part of God, as indestructible, then a problem in my life a failure, it's like, okay, somebody pushes me, I'm affected by that. I need to strengthen my, I need to stabilize myself. Maybe I need some support at that time. But that doesn't disturb us so much. So in some ways, what disturbs us reflects what shelters us. Or how we define ourselves determines, or what disturbs us reveals what we how we define ourselves. And the magnitude of the disturbance, will vary. So if we have a spiritual self-conception, then life's anxieties are going to be there always. And yes, even in today's world, we can say that the anxieties are more and we can't wish them away. And we cannot really expect that the whole world will become spiritualized. But at least if we get a sense of our own spiritual identity, that will help us to avoid getting that much disturbed. Yam labdhva chaparam labham manyate nadhikam tataha yasmin stito na dukkhena gurunapi vichalyate. 622. Krishna says that even great distress will not disturb you. That is quite a significant statement. So in one sense, what you said about Stephen King saying that there's a moment of peace and suddenly all hell breaks loose. The Bhagavatam also says that padam padam yad vipadam, there can be danger at any moment. And we have the story of Gajendra, where he was enjoying in a scenic resort kind of setting, what we would call today. And suddenly he was caught by a crocodile. So the acknowledgement of the uncertainty and the, at one level, the utter unpredictability of life, that doesn't have to fuel chronic anxiety within me. It can also fuel serious spirituality. So we don't want to deny the presence of uncertainty, but what is the result of that? If my self-conception is materialistic, then it will fuel anxiety within me. But if my self-conception is spiritual, then it will inspire me to become more committed to my own spirituality, and thereby that can give me stability, that can give me even serenity, and then I can deal with the anxiety better.
Yes. I think we should end part one here. Then we can.
Yes, definitely. I think there's one more point which you mentioned. I'll quickly respond to that and then we can summarize. When we talk about the sheer amount of, like we talk loneliness, we will talk about tomorrow, maybe in the next session, about love being extrinsic or intrinsic. But when there is so much anxiety in the world, quite often the consumerist culture, it makes us seek more the very things that have triggered the anxiety. So if I have financial instability, if I'm worried that I may lose money, what is the security? Earn more money. Now, of course, it is. Yeah, you can prepare for emergencies, and saving for emergencies is actually a Vedic ethos that is not practiced so much in the Western world. Now, people just earn and spend, and a sign of prudence is to save. So it's not against earning and saving. But if we start thinking that this very thing, doing it more, is going to solve my anxiety, then we are actually creating trouble for ourselves. Like Einstein said that the problems cannot be solved at the same level of consciousness that originated them.
Yes.
If my anxiety is about money, getting more money is not going to remove my anxiety, because that anxiety is not actually about money. If my anxiety is only about money, okay, you get some money, you relieve it. But if my anxiety is that my self-worth is defined by my money, then getting more money is only going to make me more dependent on money for defining my self-worth, not on changing my conception of what gives me self-worth. So that our self-worth is also shaped by our relationships. So how we view others and how others view us, that is important. And I think that could be a topic which we'll discuss in our next session.
Yes.
So should I summarize, or would you like to summarize?
No, summarize.
Okay. So talked about the ugly rainbow of consumerism and he talked about three colors within that rainbow. First was that idea of meritocracy. Now, rainbow, because rainbows look attractive, but when you go there, actually there's nothing to touch. And this is a deceptive rainbow because what looks attractive turns out to be troublesome. So traditionally it was thought that in hierarchical societies, aristocratic societies, one's past determines one's present and future. Meritocracy determines, says that our present alone determines our future. So the problem with this is that in the world, results don't always come in terms of our efforts, because there's so many other factors. So our, neither our achievements nor our abilities are solely in our control. So we discussed the example of Arjuna, who was able to tolerate the sudden disappearance of his phenomenal archery abilities by his spirituality. So if we understand that my abilities come from God, and it's like the water is flowing through the river, I don't generate the water, but I go and take it. So even if the water doesn't flow, that doesn't devastate me. And we see our abilities as means of connecting ourselves with the Lord. So even if those abilities are not impressive in the world's eyes, still I can connect with the Lord and can experience some spiritual satisfaction. You give the example of the wallet, that stealing somebody else's wallet is like taking credit for somebody else's abilities. Using my own wallet is like, okay, I'm being basically honest, but if I understand this wallet, my abilities are actually a gift, then I use it to take it back to the owner. Then, based on that, he talked about meritocracy to conception of work. So people define themselves in terms of their work. At a functional level, that is fine, but at a fundamental level, that is problematic. Because then if somehow something goes wrong in our profession, then it's like it's not just somebody pushing me, but it's like an earthquake under me. It devastates me. And when we let our work define us, then work doesn't become a source of livelihood. It becomes a source of our self-identity. And we earn not just because we need money. We earn because our self-worth is determined by our net worth. And that doesn't, then if certain works are glamorized in society, then we seek at all costs to do those works only, even if they are incompatible for us, and even if others are required. So there is no dignity of labor, which is there if work defines us. So the healthy situation is we understand that we are spiritual beings, and based on the kind of gifts I have, we define our work. And then that led to the third point of anxiety, that if I let my work define me, then I'm constantly in anxiety because the things might go wrong at any time. And we live in an increasingly uncertain world, because sudden big changes can globalize the economy, affect everyone. But the irony or the paradox is that we did have a significant amount of certainty more than in the past in terms of basic needs, and yet there is greater anxiety than the past, because the anxiety is not caused by circumstantial changes. The anxiety is caused by existential doubts. So if I see my self-worth as dependent on whether I'm superior to others or inferior to others, then that is a very insecure way to live. And acknowledging the uncertainty of the world can either intensify our anxiety, or it can intensify our spirituality. So if we understand that I am a soul who is part of God, then that can help us to cope with anxiety better. Did I leave out any points?
No.
So thank you very much. We'll continue next time then.
Yes, sir.